right emotions and perhaps the right words, but it begs the damn question, what the hell's going on in the United States of America? What the hell's wrong with us? And when are we going to come to grips with this? When are we going to put down our arms, literally and figuratively, our politics, stale rhetoric, finger-pointing, all the hand-wringing consternation that produces nothing except more fury and frustration, more scenes like this repeated over and over and over again. I say that not as a governor. I say that as a father of four. I say that as a member of this community, cares deeply about it. So we'll have time to work through all of that. But one thing I just wanted to briefly speak to is the pain in those victims. We just had the privilege of spending the last few hours with the victims that are waiting to just learn if their loved one is still alive. They're dialing the phones, they can't find it. They're trying to go on and find a phone of a loved one. Waiting to hear from the coroner, waiting to hear from any of us, just desperate to find out if their brother, their son, their dad, their mom is still alive. Just imagine being in there. I know everybody wants all the answers to all these questions, but there's no more important question and no more important answers that we owe than the victims of this senseless and tragic shooting. And so I'm not just going to express my condolences. I'm not just going to express the usual platitudes. But let me just thank the heroism of those victims. The fact that they can even stand up and support one another is remarkable. What a human act. And so I just want to, we just want folks to know we're going to be there for the victims. I want folks to know, you know, I'm here for you, Mr. Mayor, and the county, this state. And I know we have elected officials of all political stripes who want to be here for this nation. But it's time to deal with the endemic before this pandemic of gun violence, the pre-existing condition that somehow sort of pushed aside last year, but now has raised its ugly head again this year. And wake up to this reality and take a little damn responsibility, all of us, to do a little bit more and a little bit better this time and move beyond the platitudes and the usual rhetoric that tends to mark not just these moments, but the aftermath of these moments. As all of you go away and this fades out of you, and then we rinse and repeat someplace else in this country. So again, to the victims, to those that lost their lives and the families, lost their loved ones, yes, our hearts go out, but we are resolved to not make this meaningless, but to bring meaning at this tragic moment in our state and our nation's history. Again, thank you to all the men and women behind me and their courageousness and the incredible, incredible bravery that was demonstrable of the men and women, our San Jose Police Department and Sheriff's Office.
Governor, what do you say to the people who say California has some of the toughest gun laws?
So next we're going to introduce Valley Transportation Authority Chair President Glenn Hendricks.
As you all know, a horrible tragedy has impacted the VTA family, the organization, and our whole community. And our thoughts and love go out to all the employees who have been directly and indirectly impacted by this horrible event. I want to let you know that the families have been moved to the Family Assistance Center at the Red Cross to continue to have meet with counselors about what's happening. We're really grateful for the outpouring of support that has come from union leadership and transit organizations from across the country. The VTA has suspended its light rail service and will probably be suspended for several days as we work through being able to get back into the yard. We'll be setting up bus bridges to go ahead and help get our customers around. We're asking that our customers be patient with us as we work through this event and try and recover our service. And I also want to thank all the law enforcement that's been involved in their quick reaction and the way that they've been dealing with everyone who's involved by this. And once again, I want to say how terribly sorry I am and want to thank everybody in the VTA family who's been so affected.
Next, we're going to introduce the President of the County Board of Supervisors for Santa Clara County, Mike Wasserman, and County Supervisor Cindy Chavez.
It was 2 years ago, mass shooting in Gilroy.
and law enforcement responded quickly and minimized the number of fatalities. Last year we had COVID, still have COVID, but last year was the big year, and the people and the county responded so as to have the lowest positivity rate in the state. Today we had this mass shooting here, and it was the Santa Clara County Sheriff's Department and the San Jose Police Department that responded so quickly to minimize the loss of lives. As you can see, our flag now is at half mast to help commemorate and remember the people that have passed today. It is an extremely sad day in the history of Santa Clara County, but I'm also very proud of the response by law enforcement and then the VTA family taking care of the loved ones, the survivors of those that passed, and the district attorney's office that has stepped forth with the services they've provided 2 years ago to the people in Gilroy and continue to provide every day and will provide to the survivors, loved ones, and family of those that passed. It is a sad day in Santa Clara County history, but I'm very proud of the response, including the unions that have come forward with funding and help. Santa Clara County is a family, and you're seeing that go into effect today. My condolences to all the family members and friends of those that passed today.
You know, let me start by just reminding everybody that the backbone of Santa Clara County throughout COVID-19 was all the essential workers, and none were more essential than making sure people could get to their places of work. And VTA never stopped. It didn't stop light rail, it didn't stop buses, it didn't stop helping move people from point A to point B. These heroes that we all learned how to call essential workers heroes, we're now calling on them to be heroes again. There's a fund that's been set up for these families, and by going to workingpartnerships.org, anybody who wants to make a contribution to the families that have been impacted, the VTA families that have been impacted, can do that directly by going to workingpartnerships.usa.org. I just want to close with this point. While my heart breaks, I can't stop thinking about what we could all be doing differently to stop this in our community so this doesn't become something that just happens here, but something that should never happen. And thank all of you for being here.
Next, I'm going to introduce Mayor of San Jose, Sam Liccardo.
It's been said before, but it's worth saying again, our hearts are broken for the family members who have lost their loved ones, for our VTA family members who have lost their friends and colleagues. I'm joined here by Councilmember Ralph Brawls, South Boston, dear friend, Councilmember Matt Mahan. These are members of our community. These are members of our families. And right now, this moment is for mourning and for supporting those families and friends and loved ones. And we're going to do everything we can here at the city with all of our partners, and I'm so grateful for how everyone has stepped up, the Valley Transportation Authority and the county, and to have the governor come down here. Literally came down here, said, I don't need to speak to anybody on any stage or anything, I just want to be here for the families. For hours he spent with the rest of us simply to be here with us. Everyone has stepped up in such a tremendous way, showing the heart of our community and how we care in times of tragedy. Tomorrow, we're going to have a vigil at 6 p.m. at San Jose City Hall. We know that our entire community will need this moment and many others to mourn together. And so we want to bring people together to be able to at least share a common humanity, particularly given all that we've been through over the last year and a half. This is a time when we need to be together. I want to thank Working Partnerships USA and South Bay Labor Council for setting up a fund, and we encourage anyone who wants to give to help support families in this difficult time to please give generously to that fund. These are, as Supervisor Chavez said so well, these are the women and men who support our community through this pandemic. They showed up at work every day as essential workers, despite risk to their own health. And they did it because they understood their mission, their commitment to public service. We owe them and their families so much. And I am so grateful for the San Jose Police Department and the Sheriff's Office that responded so quickly, undoubtedly saving lives as a result. We will continue to show our resolve as a community to come together. And as the governor indicated, we've got a lot of work to do to start to work on solutions. That work is still ahead of us. For now, we focus on everything we can do to support these families and their loved ones. Thank you.
I'm going to pass it off to the Federal Bureau of Investigation, FBI, Special Agent in Charge of the San Francisco office, Craig Fair.
My name is Craig Fair. I'm the Special Agent in Charge of the San Francisco Division of the FBI here in the Bay Area. On behalf of the FBI, I'd like to express our condolences to the families of victims, VTA family, and to the city of San Jose in the wake of this tragic crisis of which the FBI is no stranger to responding to. The FBI is assisting the city of San Jose, the San Jose Police Department, and Santa Clara Sheriff's Office in this investigation. They are lead. We are providing assistance in the form of evidence response and recovery. We are flying national assets from Quantico, Virginia. We will be providing ballistics, technical forensic equipment and analysis. We will be bringing teams in from other divisions throughout the FBI to assist in the analysis of the crime scene. That is going to take some time. It is complex. We are very deliberate. We are required to map, catalog evidence, and that is going to take some time, and I'm asking your patience in that process. We are also providing victim assistance, victim services during this crisis to help families heal. We will be here as long as needed and continue to provide that assistance. I would also like to commend the first responders, the officers who went in at their own peril to assist in taking out victims. Thank you very much.
Special Agent, could you describe a little bit how complex this is? It looks like it's multiple buildings. You're already starting to map, and I see some of that. This is a really, you're talking multiple locations, right?
It is multiple locations. It is, as I said, it's a very sizable crime scene. We are currently in there looking at how we need to go and how we need to process that. That is also going to take some time before we actually start processing this.
Any idea how long, days,
week? Potentially looking at days, but I don't want to get into that right now, Steve.
Pass it off to Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms, ATF Assistant Special Agent in Charge, Joshua Jackson.
Good afternoon. My name is Joshua Jackson. I'm the Assistant Special Agent in Charge with ATF San Francisco Field Division. ATF definitely wants to express our deepest condolences to the victims who lost their lives or injured, the families and friends of those individuals, as well as community at large who are suffering at this time. ATF is here supporting this investigative effort, as well as providing all of our experts in firearms, arson, explosives, to include our certified fire investigators, our certified explosives specialists, as well as our explosive detection canines. In addition to our personnel, we're also providing firearm ballistics information, resources related to our National Integrated Ballistic Information Network, NIBIN, as well as tracing. ATF is committed to reducing violent crime throughout all communities that we serve throughout the United States. And we're committed to see this one through, supporting our investigative partners here in this investigative team. Thank you.
Joshua, can you talk about the different dogs? We've seen, like, all kinds. They have different specialties. Can you talk about that?
I can comment on the ATF explosive detection canines that we have. Currently, we have 5 ATF explosive detection canines that have been deployed to support investigative efforts. And those canines are being deployed on the scene.
Talk about the importance of NIBIN in this case.
NIBIN's important as far as it provides ATF and our investigative resources the ability to be able to trace firearms and ballistics evidence to link it to other firearm crimes or other crimes that might be involved. It's not to say that the evidence here has not been processed for NIBIN yet. The crime scene is still being processed as we speak. Evidence is still being taken into custody. That will take place at a later date.
You use NIBIN, is that correct?
So we're going to pass it off next to San Jose Police Department Chief Anthony Monta.
Good afternoon. I want to extend my sincerest condolences to the victims, our family, and our community. There's no doubt that the courageous acts of our men and women at the San Jose Police Department saved lives and helped rescue the over 40 employees that were present at this facility. Again, I'm extremely proud at the partnership that we have with our Sheriff's Department, the Fire Department, our federal partners, to limit the loss and the tragedy that has occurred today. We are here to support our community, our families, and our law enforcement partners as we are help them with their investigation. Thank you for your continued support of the San Jose Police Department and of all law enforcement here in the county.
Next, we're going to introduce the San Jose Fire Department Chief, Robert Sapien, Jr.
Good afternoon. My name is Robert Sapien, San Jose Fire Department Fire Chief. This morning, at about 6:30 a.m., three significant incidents unfolded that required us to mobilize all of our on-duty available resources. Unfortunately, the second of those events was the Younger incident, where our personnel were dispatched to an emergency medical services call, and ultimately we learned it was this active shooter event. Our personnel very quickly employed their training and equipment, which allows them to tactically integrate with law enforcement officers. In today's event, there is some relief in reporting to you that the operations could not have gone more efficiently or effectively. The training that our firefighters receive in cooperation with our law enforcement partners allows them to treat trauma victims as quickly as possible to give them their best chance at survival. At today's event, as I said, operations ran as trained. And so we are very thankful that we were able to be here to provide assistance. We are very sad for the losses in our community, and we continue to be present to support our community. Thank you.
Can you describe the three events?
So I'm going to introduce next is Gene Cohen, from the South Bay Labor Council.
Good afternoon. My name is Gene Cohen. I'm the executive officer of the South Bay Labor Council. We are here with all the working men and women in Santa Clara County to stand with our ATU brothers and sisters. Today is about supporting victims. It's about sending love and support to everyone who came to work this morning intending on serving the public and ended up not going home. It's unacceptable, and what we're asking for right now is for there to be respect and love that's dedicated and shown to all of these workers. They need money, they need support, and we need to make sure that their families are also being respected in terms of giving them their space to mourn. So thank you so much for the opportunity to make sure that all of our workers have the opportunity to let you know that when you go to work, you should be able to go back safely, and that right now we're going to be making sure that as a family, we're taking care of each other. Thank you very much.
Okay, I just would like to close by saying this is an active sheriff's office investigation, and we will continue to provide you updates, but again, the deputy sheriffs from the sheriff's office, the officers from San Jose Police Department ran into the building where shots were being fired, and I know that it saved many lives. Thanks to the fire department also. So being part of our active shooter protocol and our rescue team. So we had some heroics that I think resulted in a diminished loss of life. You know, we're real proud of the people who serve in this county and that responded to this incident. And we will take some questions, and you can direct the questions at any of the speakers if you would like.
Can you please explain any more details as to how deputies even in general terms, where the fatalities were located? Were they all located inside the building on a particular level? Can you explain what that building was used for?
So in regards with fatalities and locations, like I was saying earlier, it's still preliminary at this point. So one, we have to get the Sheriff's Office bomb squad in there to clear the area for investigators to go in and conduct their investigation. So this is going to be a very timely and methodical situation. So it's going to take a lot of time. So I don't have that information.
Quick follow-up, though. All the bodies are found inside the facility in the building or outdoor?
It's within that facility area. I don't have those answers at this point. It's still preliminary. It can be either. I don't have that information at this point. It's still preliminary.
Has anybody wounded? You talk about
so, on top of the fatalities that I mentioned, there is one person at a local trauma hospital with that is listed in critical condition at the point.
Was the shooter a legal gun owner, and can you say what the weapon was that he used?
Right now, I don't have that information in regards to what weapon was used in that information.
So, are there bodies that are still inside the facility that you have not been able to recover and remove yet? And is that why there has been some delay in definitively telling family members what's happened to loved ones and they can't get in contact?
Yeah, so we have investigators on scene with the Santa Clara County Coroner's Office right now. So they're doing their investigation to follow up, see what they have, and also contact the next of kin. We just want to make sure we ensure the privacy for the family and loved ones that were involved in this situation.
Were there any weapons recovered from the house?
I'm sorry?
Were there any weapons recovered from the house?
That's still ongoing. Weapons regarding with the suspect's house, we don't have that information right now. It's still ongoing in that case.
What is the connection between the fire at his house and the shooting? Did the fire erupt before he left to go to?
So I know there's some speculation saying there's a house fire within the city of San Jose and then something involvement with this. Again, we're using the investigators to see determine if there is any type of connection to that case, but right now it's still preliminary and ongoing. Yes, sir. I don't have that information at this point, so if, in regards with the house fire. Any other questions?
And the explosives were discovered or indicated by an explosives detection dog in the building?
Correct. So there's an explosives detection dog, an EOD dog is what we call, that detected on a suspicious device. Immediately we activated the Santa Clara County Sheriff's Office bomb squad, and they're going to use their protocol and pretty much canvas that whole area to ensure that it's safe for our investigators to go in and conduct their investigation at that point. So it's going to be a very timely, methodical. We're going to be there throughout the night to clear every room and every crevice of that building. We know that is a very big building, and we're going to use everything because we want to ensure the safety for the deputies and investigators and everyone else around that it's clear and safe.
Are they just searching the building, or will they also search the light rail trains, tracks, the area around?
We're going to search everywhere. We're going to do everything in all our all do for us, and we're going to use all the resources that we have, and that's why we have multiple surrounding law enforcement agencies here, including federal agencies to assist us with the investigation. I don't know if it was a drive-by, it was a passerby, or somebody inside the building that called 911, but it got received to us at 6:34 this morning. I don't know if they were in the same place. I know that they were employees. I'll tell you that the suspect that was deceased is an employee from BTA. One more question, then we're going to wrap it up. I'm sorry.
Can you describe the explosives that were found?
It's still preliminary. The bomb squad's doing everything they can to utilize and
bombs
find
or explosive material.
Everything. We're going to use everything from precursor chemicals to any type of explosive devices to any type of objects and materials. We're going to use all of that and determine exactly what
we
have.
Has a dog sniffed one? Has any more been found, or is it just the one for right now?
Once we have one type of, when the dog smells on something and has a scent, we're going to activate the bomb squad and we're going to utilize those resources from there. I don't know. That's still, again, preliminary, and we're still trying to get that information. What I'll tell you right now, just to wrap things up, this is our last press conference for today regarding this incident. Again, please give us patience and time with this. We want to be very methodical, very transparent, and make sure we do a thorough investigation on this. So please give us time. I know you want more information. Please bear with us. And then once we have more information, we will send out an updated press release department, or press release statement from our agency. Okay? Thank you, everybody.
About the three different incidents, what were the three different incidents? And utilize all your resources.
Thank you for the question. A little more information on the three incidents. So at 0629 this morning, we received a report of fire on Smith Avenue, which is a commercial area of town, or commercial industrial, rather. That ultimately was a second alarm fire. The second incident, as I said, was this incident here on Younger, and the latter was in a residential area in town on Angmar Court. That's A-N-G-M-A-R Court, and that ultimately was a second alarm fire.
And what time did that third call come in?
The third call was at 0636 hours. The information I have is that the fire on Angmar is under investigation, and that's all I know at this time.
Okay.
I do not have any information.
Any special precautions that the firefighters had to take as they were running in here today?
Our firefighters are equipped with ballistic protection, which is a bulletproof vest, helmet, and goggles type of equipment.
And they had to utilize those?
And they utilized that by policy.
Any victims of the fire?
I do not have reports of fatality.
So we're going to wrap up this press statement. Everyone here will be here for individual interviews if you're interested, and then we'll wrap that up. Thank you for everyone for coming out. Mm-hmm.